that you are for me. I pray because you're for me.
Thank you. clapping, so you have to see if you got coordination this morning.
You I want to see you. Ready to do stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's a word that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it, but it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I needed, but it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. Jesus, I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I have made it. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. All about you.
My comfort. by the word that they were touched to cry out
not just saying, "Duh, what should we do?" They cried out, wanting help. What to do? What should I do here? Then Peter said to them, "Repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call." And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, "Be saved from this perverse generation." Then those who gladly received his word were baptized. And that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods, and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. I have to do a quick review from last week. Our concern is that today less than 10% of Americans who say they're converted follow Jesus. These are statistical evidences. You go to a crusade, a Billy Graham crusade or whatever, you have lots of people making statements, but they will not stay through. And Acts 100% did. It didn't say at the end of his sermon, 300 went and stayed continuous with them, and 90% went back and did their old thing. It says the 3,000, all of them, participated continuously and stuck to the church. They went together. Now, why is there such a difference today when we can barely get 10% of people who make, quote, decisions actually follow through? There's three things that I mentioned last week. They had a thorough knowledge of Scripture. These Jewish people were trained the Scriptures from their youth. They knew the law of God. They knew the teachings of Scripture. So one thing is, because they were saturated with truth, when they were exposed to the good news as Peter preached it, there was a lot of stuff already built into their minds, their wills and emotions that were there as ammunition for God to use to stab their hearts. Secondly, they were given the gospel and the power and the love of the Holy Spirit. That's one of the issues that we must really face today, whether we are saturated with the love of God in our churches. Many churches are filled with backstabbing, with talking behind people's backs, gossiping. They're filled with, "I don't like that person. He always makes me mad at them," and stand there and not like each other and look across the room and glare at each other. There's a lot of things at business meetings that are built for war, like World War II, instead of love, unity, and so forth. Our church has become politically motivated, friendship motivated, and we have to guard against the things that destroy the unity and love of God. And with our reputations so badly scoured because of our attitudes, we've hurt God's name. Therefore, we have to repent and go back to the first works of love, and no matter what it takes, bring love and unity to the body of Christ. Thirdly, they understood the relationship of persecution and receiving the power of the Holy Spirit. They gladly were stolen. Their goods were stolen from them. They suffered distress. And it says they would rejoice and thank God to be worthy of being persecuted for Christ's sake. We go, "God, why have you left me? Forgive me for being so self-absorbed, Lord. Thank you that you consider me worthy to suffer for your namesake." We have got a long ways to go in the 21st century compared to the first century Christians in heart. Our present concern is real simple. Then the church tries to make people decide to follow Jesus Christ. And decision isn't the only issue that we want to do. But some of the things I mentioned last week, in regular research, one group found that 3 to 5% of the people who make decisions take further steps and get involved in growth and join a church. This means 95 to 97% hardly ever do anything but make that decision, go home and live their life like they used to. annual reports from various ministries. This one of a denomination of 11,500 churches reported in 1 year that they had 294,784 decisions or supposedly conversions, but they only could find 14,337 who joined the church. 280,000 of them that they claimed became Christians never even went to church afterwards. That's not like the first century. Also, they reported an evangelistic crusade, 18,000 decisions. For example, 94% failed to ever go to a church and be baptized and do anything. Yet they wrote on their cards that they made a decision to follow Jesus. Our terrible results in 20th century America has no comparison to what it was like in the scriptures of long ago. We are far from truth. Here are some of the issues I want you to remember. First of all, they base their faith on God's word. It says, they that gladly received his word. Those that gladly received made a step of obedience immediately. They chose a simple sign of obedience. They were baptized. But in that day, in the Jewish community where they started here, that was not a small matter. They basically told their families, you're wrong. Your religion is wrong. You are against God's Messiah. I'm sorry. I'm going to make a change here. Now, think about it, you Christians. It'd be like your child coming home and say, you know what? You taught me Christianity and Jesus and all that stuff, but you know what? I'm going to be a Hindu. You'd be like, what? Where'd that come from? A sudden, absolute change. They did not see Jesus as a true Messiah, but a false Messiah. That's why they had him killed. They were against him. And suddenly, they're telling their family and friends goodbye. And you know, the Jews, even some today, get so irritated by this concern. There's been reported cases in America where the Jewish families will then set up a funeral. They'll actually get a casket, and they will bury their son or daughter who becomes a Christian. And they never want anything to do with them again. To be baptized. It's a big deal some places. To hear it's not. People get baptized and it doesn't mean a whole lot. The Word of God says faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. We must preach the whole counsel of God. And I want to show you where we have not tended to do that in our century. Now, I also talked through this, and this is what I'm going to quickly review before I start my actual message today. The issue that Jesus said, here's how I see when people fall away. We keep talking about the 90% or the 94% I just showed you. There's a problem with the heart, and this is where Jesus taught the truth in this manner. In Matthew chapter 13, he taught a very simple parable, and it had to do with the way seed was planted. That seed by the farmer was actually God's word. The ground, or the dirt, was the heart of man, is what he explains here. And he says that as some people take that word of God and try to plant it in the heart or in the soul of a person, they hit the wayside where their heart is not prepared. It's hard because there's no penetration into the very ground to be able to produce any fruit. It absolutely does nothing. The second group of people had a little bit softer ground, but the seed couldn't go in deep because right underneath the surface was more stone. So it couldn't grow. Even though there was a more of an appreciation or acceptance, it wasn't enough to make any difference in that person's life. Thirdly, the other person is so full of the world, so full of making money, so full of making pleasure, having fun, going to sports and whatever, that there's not enough room for the seed of God's word to produce anything. And so therefore, it's also dealt death to the word of God. Only in the fourth group, the good soil or the good ground, was there anything that happened. That ground was clear of all the weeds, clear of all the rocks. It was ready to take seed, and when God's word was planted into that good heart, it produced fruit 30, 60, and 100 fold from what that one seed had. It produced a lot of things, and it says in the scripture in this point, Jesus said, those who understood the word are the ones who had the good heart. Now, we need to make sure we understand what all that means. Understand is the key concern that God had here. Do I understand the message of the kingdom of God? Do you understand it so that it can be planted into your spirit and produce fruit? Even though you've heard it many times, maybe you went to church 100 times, 200 times, 20 years, 30 years, do you still have understanding of what the kingdom message is all about? Have you responded to the kingdom message? Well, Jesus explained this falling away of many cases as decision making. Like that first person decided they didn't want to hear it. I don't need this. Second one said, I'm kind of excited about it, but I don't have that much interest. The third made decisions, but changed decisions because other things in the world were more important to them. Only the fourth one made more than a decision. It brought changed life. And what we're after in you and in me, and what God's after, I should say, is changed life, where we are like those of Acts 2, leaving behind what they once had and now becoming fanatics for Jesus is basically what they want to call it today. I love the labeling that Americans do with words today. Suddenly, you're a fundamentalist means you're some kind of wild-eyed weirdo who goes around beating people into the kingdom of God and driving through parking lots and throwing eggs at people and going to abortion clinics and burning them down and shooting the doctors. Those are supposed to be fundamentalists. That's not what fundamentalism is at all. Foundations are fundamentals. They teach it to kids in sports. Fundamentals is you do the main thing and make sure you understand the foundation so you can accomplish your task, whether it's sports or life or whatever. And being fundamental or foundational is the truth that we follow the teachings of the Word of God all the way through to the very core of our being so that it comes out of our lives every day. And that's what God's after, a changed life. And so I want you to see, now the second thing I want you to see is they transferred the power of genuine love and divided them into goods, is what it said. They took their goods as was necessary and they shared it with other people who had needs. And I want you to understand very simply that if you have the power of God, love is the key issue. Love is explained, illustrated, and valued and propagated by what you do, not what you say. Right? And this love that they showed right away, these converts of 3,000, didn't just say, yeah, I think I'll go to church maybe next Sunday if I think about it. Instead, they became fanatical. They were willing to give up of their own stuff as they saw needs in other people. They would take and sell their lamp if they had to so that their other friend wouldn't go hungry. They took the shirt off their back, that old expression, to care for those that they're now with their new family, that new 3,000 plus the other people in the church. They did everything they could to make sure their friends were okay. That's the power of love. And when Del Rio Fellowship shows that kind of love, no one will want to be here, right? Oh, no, that's not how it is it? When we show that kind of love, you won't be able to keep people away, right? That's the power of the message of God and His Word. Thirdly, and this is the key where I want to start kicking into from what last week. The third thing that you notice back in that scripture, if you look at it, especially in verse 36 and 37, when Peter spoke, he spoke to them and said, "You have murdered the Messiah." He didn't say, "God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life." He took the law of God and as a spear thrust it at them straight in their face. And said, "You have murdered the Messiah. You broke the law of God, first of all, because you murdered. Secondly, you resisted God because His anointed one, the one He picked, you've defied, murdered, and resisted. You are against the will of God." He was tough on them. He threw a spear or cast a sword into their hearts to go for the very conscience of His hearers. The law of God is declared by Paul and many others, if you read the New Testament through, is spoken over and over again. The law is made not for the righteous, but for the wicked. It's done to bring, as a schoolmaster, the wicked to Christ. And we must not let the world tell us, "Oh, you're so negative. How can you say such things like, you're right and we're wrong?" You have to be tolerant toward us and others. How can you dare say, see, you're going to get the wrath of our community and the wrath of our nation because they do not believe in absolute right and wrong. What's good for them is good for them. What's good for you is good to be. You're into religion? That's a good thing. But don't tell me I'm wrong. And don't tell me I'm going to go to hell. Don't tell me any of this stuff. And so you're going to find people not like you if you give the truth. But unless we tell the truth, they have no hope of salvation. So we have to walk a thin line of love and truth. You know, one time I was working at my gas station as a manager back up when I was in Michigan. My father used to run a gas station. He moved to Florida back in 1970. What? 75. And I got the blessing. I worked for him, and they actually promoted me to be the manager. And so I start working in, basically at a gas station, you get low pay. So you only get like high school kids that want to work. I remember one time I had a high school kid that came and got a job from me, and one day I was there and he came into work to take the second shift, and I felt God start to tell me, I got to tell this kid he's going to go to hell. It's like, Lord, I don't go around telling people they're going to go to hell. That's not a way to win their love and listening ear. And I just kept sensing God say, I need to tell him that he's going to go to hell. It's like, okay. So I just kind of laid it out there. I said, you know, I just wanted to let you know that I want to share with you that God wants me, you know, I kind of dribbled it out there. But I think God's trying to tell me that you're going to go to hell. Now, when usually you think of a guy going, yeah, get out of my face. And that kid responded with, really? I couldn't believe the response. He was like taken back. And it's like, wow. And the other time I get people angry with me when I say that. And as I began to share the message of God to him, he took a track home. And seemed to be really bothered by that. And as God began to work in his life, he came back to me a few days later when he worked again and said, I lost the track. It's like, how do you lose the track? Okay, I'll get you another one. And he said, I searched my bedroom, I can't find it. So I gave him another one. He came back and he gave his life to Jesus. Today he's a youth pastor, or children's minister, excuse me, and his wife, and they serve God. All because I said some straight, you know, crazy thing like, you're going to hell. But I didn't, that's not my practice to start that way. I try to be a nicer guy at first, you know what I'm saying? Yet God used that message of stabbing the heart, and I could tell that God stabbed his heart. It was the thing he needed to hear to shake him up out of his lethargy, be out of his religious sleep, something to catch him so he would respond to the message of Jesus. And you know, that's incredible. And we have to understand that we can't always be positive. It's not a positive message when people, and just think about going to the doctor. Here's another example that's simple to you. You want to go to a doctor who's a liar, go to a doctor and say, doctor, I feel sick. And he puts it, you're doing fine. Go home. Keep doing what you want to do. Everything's great. Have fun. Enjoy life. Don't let anybody be negative towards you. Is that the kind of doctor you want? Do you want a doctor that pokes and stabs, does tests and says, oh, you know what, I found there's something here. You don't want to hear it. But yet you do because you want to make sure you can deal with it and get it out of your life, right? That's truth. I need a doctor that will be serious enough to make sure he stabs and finds that which is really a problem in my body if I need to get fixed or medicine to get it taken care of, right? And even so, the sin of mankind is a destructive force beyond anything that God's concerned about. That's his main issue of men. He knows that sin is the disease that destroys. And he needs to set us free from that. He wants to give us heaven, but he's got to deal with that sin disease that's destroying every man. And we have to bring the law to them for them to hear it. The scripture is kind of basic. The Holy Spirit's goal is to produce brokenness and conviction in the heart of every sinner. You understand that? That's his goal. Now, how do I know that from Scripture? The Scripture in John 16:8 says, and when he is come, he will convict the world of sin. First thing. See, if you want to know if God's around, it's not when you're feeling so good and joyful and pleasant. Sometimes it's because you feel bad. And again, our world hates bad feelings. We want to be self-esteem up there, all this stuff. But when you feel rotten about your sin, that's God's presence. Because we can't make ourselves feel bad about sin. The devil doesn't want you to feel bad about sin. The only thing left is it's God's presence. The Holy Spirit brings conviction, convincing to you that something in your life is wrong. That's God's desire. Because he wants to bring you into righteousness. This is a simple diagram trying to get you to picture the activity of your soul. The Bible says we're mind, will, and emotions, and that is the extent or the circle of action. It's our soul. That's different than our spirit. That's different than our body. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says, may your whole spirit, soul, and body be blessed before God. I forget how it finishes. But it deals with three parts. We're made in three parts. Now, the reason I want you to understand this mind, will, and emotions is because most of our message has to do with only getting to the soul. We don't get to the spirit. We don't accomplish God's task that he wants. See, the heart is the spirit. And in the spirit is where you're born again. In the spirit is where you have contact with God. In your spirit is where the things that God needs to deal with start from. Then it moves out. You know, if you've been in church long enough, you might have heard the big fancy word sanctification. Sanctification is the saving of the soul part. Changing your mind, renewing your mind to truth. It's the saving part of your soul where your will becomes more surrendered to God step by step. So you leave the things behind that God doesn't want as you embrace the things he does. It's the salvation of the soul, the sanctification is where your emotions become so that you get excited about what makes God excited and you get sad about the things that makes God sad. That's sanctification, the saving of your soul. But you have to start with the saving of your spirit to be born again. Now here's what the word says in Hebrews. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, and is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the center, spirit, your heart. See how clear that is? God's word must go past the soul, past your mind, past your will, past your emotions, and pierce into your spirit to produce fruit. Hear me? I would not have known sin except through the law. For I would not have known covetousness unless the law had said, you shall not covet. The law is the spear or the sharp sword that must pierce through into our innermost being. The law is God's method to school us to Jesus. You hear me so far? This is so important because I'm going to challenge you with your salvation that you think you have at the end. I'm so worried about this, you see, because I was raised in the church. I was raised here from the time I only got 1 week off for good behavior when I was born. And then my mom dragged me to church every day from that point in my life. I've always been in the church. And I thought I got saved when I was a child. But you know, when I became a teenager, when I came to church, I dreamed about my car and my girls, friends, you know, the cool ones. And I thought about everything else, football. And then when I went home and my mom said, well, hey, what would you learn today? I learned that my car is so cool. And I couldn't remember what they talked about in church because I heard nothing. I had no understanding of truth. But yet I professed Jesus when I was a little child. And when I was 19 years old, the Spirit of God took a spear and thrust it through my soul and hit me square in the middle and let me know that he was not my God, that my sin was a corruption before him, and my pride and my immorality and all the sins that just were oozing out of my heart were an abomination before him. And I was converted at 19. And yet I lived my life to that point thinking I was going to heaven when instead I was going straight to hell. And I've got to make sure that you understand what salvation is so you can't profess a false salvation. I can't allow you to go to hell thinking you're going to go to heaven. You hear me? And so that's my passion for you today to understand this. So I'm going to labor a little bit in it, but I need to for your sake. The work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness, is a clear indication that God works through your spirit with his law in your conscience, which is part of your spirit. And between themselves, their thoughts accusing or else excusing them, it says in Romans. Conviction, then, is very simple. Brokenness is a simple thing that God wants. Just like it said there, it stabbed them in the heart, and they cried out. The issue that God wants is his word to go past your soul, this outer barrier, mind, will, and emotions, and stab into your conscience so that your conscience will cry out and say, oh, man, I'm guilty before God. And unless I get to your conscience, you will not be saved. Here's why. The natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God. That means your natural soul, your brain, your mind can't understand what the truth of God is because they're spiritually discerned. The word must be given into your spirit before you can understand. And understanding that only comes from God's Spirit planting God's word in your good heart. See that? And so it's got to come deep within you. Now, Peter's words stabbed their consciences, and that's why they cried out and said, "What shall we do?" So here's the salvation message problem that I have today that we're going to have and that we need to address to you before you leave. I can't just come to your minds. A lot of teenagers come and say, "Oh, church is boring." And their minds, they think, "Oh, brother." A lot of adults do that too, I'm sure. But the thing that I want you to notice difference between these people and that, they did not go and say, "Oh, I only want to listen to Peter preach because he's got it. He's the best preacher of all the disciples." It says they were dedicated to the teachings of the Word. They didn't play that game we do in America. "Oh, I go to this church because he's a great preacher." That's not the issue. In God, it's the truth is being proclaimed, and I'm dedicated to the truth. But today we have, "I'm dedicated to the preacher. He's the great one. I'm going to go to his church. Wherever he goes, I'm going to because he's a great one." The next thing, if we appeal just to the emotions, and I can do that, and churches do that all the time, I can weep at the right time. I can weep, but I don't do it at the right time always. Play a certain kind of music that you can feel the tingles, and your emotions start to rise up a little. And we can emotionally touch you. That's not good enough because it's not your spirit. And then I can get you to make a decision. But then when you go home afterwards, you make a decision not to come back next week because you can change your mind. Decisions aren't what we need. Decisions aren't good enough. The seed, is it planted in the good soil of your heart? Let's examine that. Does God's word stab your conscience and you say, "Ooh, I am wrong. Oh, I haven't heard this." Or you sit there thinking, "Well, I hope my husband's listening to this sermon. In fact, I'm going to get a tape and bring it home to him. And my kids better hear this because they really are rotten." See, all those thoughts are of your soul and is not touching your conscience at all. Because until you say, "Ouch, that hit me," it's not your conscience. I'm not bringing any conviction to you. The wayside person says, "You know what? I'm thinking about this. I've heard you say it, but you know what? I don't really need help. I'm better than my neighbors. In fact, if I look around this room, God loves me more than the rest of these people. I'm in pretty good shape." And the hard-hearted says, "I don't need a lot of help. I'm pretty good. My conscience isn't bothered." But those who have the stony ground, they hear the message and we say, "All have sinned and come short of the glory of God." And they go, "Well, I guess if everybody sinned, it's not that bad. Okay, I want heaven." You notice they get kind of excited about it because everybody's a sinner anyway, so it still doesn't put me on the spot. I'm not any worse off than anybody else. But it's not deep enough. What about the will? Well, the weeds say, "Hey, man, I want heaven, but, man, I'm kind of busy. And, you know, I might check back in a couple weeks, go to church maybe, and, well, maybe next month even. I can see I want to go boating and fishing next week, and then I wanted to, I'll see you in a couple weeks." See, a decision is pretty weak. But here's what's really the concern. When God's word is really stabbing you in the conscience, the good heart says, "God, forgive me, I'm a liar. How can I sin against you so much? What can I do before you? I'm dirt. I'm a worm because I've defied your name. I don't care about my brother, my sister. It's me, O Lord, standing in need of prayer." Hear that old song? It's me that's in trouble. And that's the day when I was 19. When God stabbed me then, it was no longer, "I'm not so bad." I realized how wicked it was. I knew I was in trouble. I defied his name. Here I went to church all that time, and I dishonored him. And my sin was so big. I can't forget it to realize his love. And I didn't do any of the fancy prayers anymore after that. I remember standing in a group, youth group thing, and kids were singing. And all I could sense, after knowing that God should kill me, I was so evil I should be executed. And I really was stupid enough to think he might run me over with a truck or something. And as I sat there, I was hopeless. I thought I've already known the truth and I've already didn't respond, and I expected God just to throw me out. And instead, my heart became so filled with the love of God that I literally spoke out loud. And I think they probably thought I was weird because they were still singing. And all that I could say was, if you love me this much, you got me forever. I didn't say I'm a liar. He already knew it. I've been thinking about it for 6 days or 8 days. I was under such pain of my sin that I couldn't stand it. The only thing I knew to say was, I can't believe you love me after all I've done. My sin was so upon me. No one else mattered anymore. Just me and God. That's conviction of sin. And from that day on, I have followed God since 1971 in September. He's got me forever. He changed my life. I didn't care about cars anymore and girls anymore. I didn't care about anything anymore but God. I became a fanatic. Sorry for him, because he changed my heart forever. I have to ask you a simple question. Have you got that? Has there been a place in your life where God has stuck his finger at you and said, you are full of sin. You're dishonoring my name. Your sin is killing me. Your pride, your arrogance, your lies, your adultery, your fornication, your disobedience to your parents. Those are not a light matter. They crush the heart of God. They crush him. Do you agree with, does your feelings agree with him? Or do you just slough it off like I hear so many times? None of us are perfect. None of us are perfect. Jesus said, blessed are those who are poor in spirit and know it. Everybody's poor in spirit, but those who know it are the ones he's after. Then he goes right into the next point and says, blessed are those who mourn over their sin. And in each case, he gives promise. Those are the kind of hearts and character that I'm going to show blessing to. To be honest, folks, have you ever felt rotten over your wicked sins? Have you ever felt disgraced before him? Have you ever hung your head in shame and mourned for your sin? Because that's the doorway that leads to life. And if you've never taken that path, your religion is a sham. And it's a narrow way that few want to take. Because the broad way is the way we're all sinners. So, okay. What's the signs and evidence of reality then? Acts 2. The wicked sinners cried out to God. The wicked sinners turned from their ways, and with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength, they became fanatics. And they gathered together day after day after day to hear more of the book and to study it, and from house to house became friends with the saints. And together as an army of people, they searched the scriptures, loved their God, prayed to him, and broke bread together in fellowship. And they showed such love that the world said, who are these people? They've turned the world upside down with this message. And how they love one another. Can you bow your heads with me? I've got to cry to you today. Have you come to a place in your life? You might have prayed 20 times to make decisions for Jesus, but decision isn't enough. Do you know your sin? Do you know your rebellion? Do you know that you don't love God with all your heart, but you do what you want? Today I call out to you to cry to him for mercy. That's what I basically did. I was so past mercy, I thought God only should judge me. And he had to prove his mercy to me before I could even open my mouth again. If you've never come to that place in your life where you know your sins are hurting God, today's a good day. Admit, that's what confess is, your sin. And He is faithful and just to forgive you your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Let Him cleanse you now. Admit your sin before Him. Tell Him, I'm a liar, I'm a thief, I'm disobedient, I've defied you. I don't care what you want, I don't care what you've done, but now I change, Lord. Forgive me for resisting Messiah. Forgive me for refusing to have any commitment to your church. I don't want anything to do with your stuff, but I see that's wrong. Forgive me. And unto this day I surrender to you. I ask you, forgive me, O God, for my sin. And I give you back my life. You are my Lord. You're my Savior. You're my Master from this day forward. I will do anything you want. I'll serve you in any way I can. I will please you and no other. For you're my God. If you can pray that prayer, do it now in your heart. Ask His forgiveness. Speak to Him. Thank you for giving your life. I give up to you freely my offer.
Okay.